And welcome to Netflix and Kill, Cave Dwelling Edition, guys. Travis, I don't know if you know this, but I never really thought of myself as claustrophobic.
No.
But since we decided to shoot to record this one on location inside this cave, I immediately regret it.
Echo!
I don't like this. Remind me to put in the sound effects later. But who is terrified with the impending doom and crushing loneliness of a tight space? Why, it's me, Nick, the Merc with a mic, and my fellow Unapologist,
Travis,
the God of the Pod himself. And of course, we have on the great, the man, the man with class and the man with a glass, Christopher J. Herman.
Hello, everyone. I would be dead in this situation. I would. There is no way I would survive. I'd be the first one to go. Tight spaces,
no.
And darkness.
Thing is,
that'd be it.
We'd all be alive because we wouldn't. We're actually not that stupid of white people. We just wouldn't go in the fucking cave.
Listen,
That's true.
I mean, I don't think it's a coincidence. There's not a black person among the cast in this movie. Like, one, it being very British as fuck, and then two, of just be this is some serious white people shit.
Mm-hmm.
But what movie are we talking about? Well, we are talking about the 2005 film, The Descent.
There's only one way out of this chamber, and that's down the pipe.
I'm stuck! I can't breathe!
Look, Sarah, you have to calm down.
I'm coming back, okay? Okay, move! Now!
This is not good, guys.
Can we get out of here?
Which way?
I don't know.
Sarah said she saw someone back
so
there.
So what?
I don't think I saw someone. I saw someone!
No, you heard something and you saw what you wanted to see.
It's the dark. It plays tricks on people.
Pick this out of our, because we're still trying to do our creature feature thing. I mean, we took a time out for Manhunt a week back just because of our recording schedules.
Mm-hmm.
But I had a whole list of creature features I wanted done. I sent Chris the list, and out of them, he was like, "Oh, totally The Descent."
Yeah.
So is there a reason behind picking this one? I'm assuming you've seen it before.
Oh, I have many, many times. I actually own it on Blu-ray, so I even have to watch on Netflix.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
But no, The Descent, it's a well-made creature feature. You have, for the most part, likable characters. It's in a really interesting scenario, which you don't often see in many films. Like, there's only one other cave-dwelling horror movie that I know of. I can't remember off the top of my head. Yeah, that's it. And so, it just sucks. But this one is just really smartly directed, has a lot going for it. It's fun. Yeah, it's just an all around. It's a really good horror movie.
Yeah, for those of you who are familiar with The Cave, this movie is like The Cave if it was good.
Yes. that's correct.
Because The Cave almost has the exact same plot as this fucking movie.
Pretty much.
But I bet you more people have actually seen The Cave now that I think about. Well, maybe not. Like, I don't think anyone remembers The Cave either.
Have I seen The Cave?
No, you haven't seen The Cave. Unless you owned a premium channel in the late 2000s, I don't think anyone's seen The Cave.
Okay. Very specific.
They played the shit out of it on Stars or whatever the hell I was watching it on. Like, they played it over and over again. But this film is very interesting. It's about, well, you know, Chris, why don't you just give a brief synopsis of what exactly this film is actually about?
Sure. Well, the film follows six women who are all about adventuring. They love going to places that are dangerous for some reason. No idea why, but they're like, let's put our lives in danger. It'll be fun. It's a bonding experience.
We already established this. They're white.
Yeah, true. Yeah. Exactly, yeah. They're just adrenaline junkies, you know, and kind of dumb to a certain extent. Or just really easily manipulated and naive, maybe. Maybe that's a bit better description for them. But no, I mean, the film starts out where they're doing on the river rafting. One of them is with their husband and kid. Tragic accident befalls them, and now it's like, my husband and kid are dead. Oh, well. So it's been a couple years later. The friends are reuniting once again. And it's like, hey, why don't we go cave diving in the Appalachian Mountains in the United States. Which, by the way, Appalachian Mountains, creepy as fuck. A lot of weird shit happens there. So the fact that there are some cave-dwelling caveman mutants, yeah, I believe that. Yeah, that's not too unusual for the Appalachian Mountains. So they go there, dive in the cave, and then they encounter these weird, just subterranean creatures. And they're trying to get out. And that's pretty much the film. And it's really good because it's simple, it's to the point, and you see a lot of nice gory nonsense, which is what I appreciate in a creature feature film. That's what you need.
So this movie was really vicious once it got to it.
I mean, well, this film is actually very, like, it's deceptively slower. Like, there's actually, it's before one of our main casts actually dies, it's about 60 minutes in. Like I say, we're almost an hour in before we have our first casualty. But once we have our first one, holy shit.
The movie snowballs from there.
This movie kicks it. It goes from 0 to 100 real quick. Mm-hmm. Like, there is, like, and man, some of the kills in here are unbelievably vicious. And some of them, some of the kills are actually perpetrated by some of our heroes here that in the most vicious of ways. Mm-hmm. Like, they kill the fuck out of these creatures in some crazy ways.
It's funny because, like, they make a Tomb Raider reference. I'm like, did you guys play the reboots? You can't. This movie's from 2005, but I think the reboot stole from this movie.
So, watching this movie again, after having played Tomb Raider, like, for a second time through, I was like, holy shit, Tomb Raider stole so much from this movie. there's a whole scene where our main character, Sarah, is avoiding is one of the crawlers, that they're called, and she falls into the pool of, like, viscera slash water slash blood sort of thing, and she rises up out of it. I'm like, wait a goddamn second. And I remember specifically, like, that is exactly out of one of the scenes of Tomb Raider, the reboot. And Juno's main weapon is that climbing pickaxe,
yep,
which is just like Laura started to use in the game, which is, like, the first time Laura's pickaxe is actually more of an iconic weapon for Laura than her dual-wielding guns at this point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're right. Yeah.
So I feel like there's a certain level of, like, visceral imagery to this movie that has inspired a lot of really cool stuff later. I think even one of the lines earlier is just like, I'm an English teacher, not fucking Tomb Raider.
Yes, that is actually the line.
Which is great. Yeah, this movie is very interesting to me in the fact that there's some really interesting character stuff going on between some of these characters, too.
Here comes Nick's lesbian vibes.
I don't want to talk about that quite yet. I want to talk about, like, the initial, like,
Can we just talk about the first death in this movie?
Sure. it almost, like, feels like any of the deaths might be spoilers because, like, the actual thriller part of this movie takes so little.
No, I mean, like, the very first death.
Oh, you want to talk about the inciting... Yeah. Okay, so, yeah, we open on a whitewater rafting sequence, and they are, you know, wrapping up another adventure. It seems like they're kind of an adrenaline junkie group overall.
Mm-hmm.
We have Sarah is picked up by her husband and daughter. We get, like, some sort of marital, like, tension going on with, like, the husband is kind of upset about something, or there's some sort of tension in the car which causes him to look at Sarah and not pay attention to the road. Mm-hmm. And then suddenly there is a car crash with this truck carrying copper pipe. The copper pipe nails Sarah's husband in the face, Final Destination style.
Very much so.
And it's just like, hot damn! Like, it is so, like, visceral, and
we rewound it.
Yeah, it was crazy how gory that effect was, even though you don't really see his face. You just see the pipe coming out the back of the the back headrest of the seat, but it's like, damn.
Yeah, and the daughter's in the back seat, and you don't really hear a child screaming in terror.
Well, you also see a second pipe go through the middle of the window, and you can only assume that, like, things didn't work out for her either. And I love that when we pull up in the, like, this crane shot away, that we see the husband even twitch a little bit. And it's like, Jesus. It's an interesting way to start a film, for sure. And obviously, as the film goes on, Sarah is dealing with her grief in her own way. This whole cave trip is basically kind of a way to cheer her up and get her back into, like, what they view as normal sort of thing.
And of course, it doesn't really go as planned.
Well, what I find what's most interesting about this movie is the fact that Sarah is our main character, but as far as someone with an arc and who is actually the most interesting, Juno is actually the most fascinating character to me, in that she is trying to get Sarah back to where she was before, and she's wrapped up, and then it's slowly revealed, like, it might actually might have more to do with her own ego slash her own guilt, like, all wrapped up into her own weird insecurities. And it culminates later in a great, like, scene that I don't think I've ever seen in another movie quite the same like this, where there's a culmination to these two characters that is just like, well, goddamn. I remember just watching the end of this movie going, like, wow, really? We're going to end it like that? That's brutal. Dark and bold. Mm-hmm. But before we hit that, I just want to mention the director of this film, Neil Marshall. You might know him from some little films called, like, Dog Soldiers, which might be the best fucking werewolf movie ever. That's where soldiers, you know, fight werewolves.
Of course.
The title says it all. Or also fucking Doomsday, which, if you've never seen Doomsday with Rona Mitra, well, just imagine, like, Mad Max mixed with almost every other post-apocalyptic movie and all in one movie. And also Bob Hoskins is there. Look, it's great. Just go check it out if you got it.
And it looks like he's also done some of the new Lost in Space reboot.
Yeah, he's a great TV director, too. Like, I remember him on some of the episodes of Hannibal.
Okay.
Oh, Dan, I didn't even know this. He made Centurion. Centurion's a badass little film with Michael Fassbender and the Roman Empire. He's got a great, like, action, track record with, and, you know, even horror track record as well with stuff like Dog Soldiers. And I really like the design of the crawlers in this movie. Like, the crawlers are, I mean, they're kind of like subterranean rats or, like, animals. I remember Travis was like, oh shit, they've wandered onto a pack of Smeagols. Like golems from Lord of the Rings.
No, like, in the very first shot, you see one. Sarah's like, I saw something. I'm like, yeah, and whatever you fucking do, don't pick up any rings you spot in this fucking cave.
Well, you know, they're blind. Even their noses are kind of fused to their faces, so that even those seem kind of vestigial. They hunt only via sound.
They seem to actually have no other sense besides hearing.
Well, and then they climb on walls in a way that makes me think that they're part Spider-Man. Like, I don't know, like, there's this, just so many really cool, you know, things about this movie. And Chris is right in that it keeps the plot pretty simple. Chris, what did you feel about the character work in this movie as far as, you know, I mean, I really like Juno and Sarah. But I'm not sure about some of the other characters. I feel like some of the other characters are pretty thin overall. But I don't know. What did you feel about it?
Well, any horror film needs a body count, and that's why they're there. And that's fine. Sure. They do a good enough job. I don't hate any of those other characters. They're fine. I mean, one of them kind of makes a dumb decision. You know, Holly isn't too bright. Like, I'm the extreme one. I'm going to go off and, you know, explore it at a very fast pace. It's like, okay, you go ahead and do just that. And, you know, obviously that leads to consequences.
Commits suicide.
she was the only one where I was like, why are you doing this? Like, shouldn't you know better?
And she was supposed to be like she was like the main adrenaline junkie. She's like, oh, I do this for thrills, not for ease. Like, okay, hipster.
But no, you're right, Nick. Juno's actually my favorite character because she's the one that kind of has an arc throughout it, and she's caught in the most interesting scenarios in terms of what she's doing with the other characters and how, you know, basically things that she's done and how it leads to, you know, controversy and how she's manipulating other people. Like, all that stuff is really interesting. Sarah's just, she's fine. You know, I mean, what she's going through, she's suffering from, obviously, a form of PTSD with everything that happened with her family. And, I mean, they do some interesting, really vivid sequences with her. Visceral sequences, I should say. But, no, I mean, Juno, I mean, to me, is really the star of this film. She's the one I'm most interested in. It's like, oh, okay. Because she's not only doing those really kind of cool action horror sequences with these creatures, but then also it's all the character stuff on top of it. So after a while, Sarah's like, okay, I get it, you know. This is fine. You're mourning over your kids and everything like that, and you're having weird flashbacks, but it's like, eh, I'm more interested in this other character. But no, I mean, I think everyone does a good enough job. There's no one I just like, wow, that actress is just phoning it in. Like, all the characters in terms of just the all the actors in terms of the performances are doing a good job. And I think that helps the movie. That's why with so many horror films nowadays, it's like, God, or slasher films, you know, or what have you, you hate the characters. So, you know, so often where it's rare to get like something like a Get Out or an It Follows where it's like, I like these people. I don't want anything bad to happen to them. And this is the case of this movie. It's where I want these people to survive. I don't want them to get picked off. And when they do get picked off, I feel bad because it is really gory and really visceral.
Well, yeah. I also like the fact that they're all women, but it's not a big deal like they make out of it. Like,
no, not at all.
Like, I think Sarah's husband is the only like male character we see in a significant portion of the movie.
Yeah,
like,
the only times we would see him would be in the hospital.
Oh, sure.
For brief seconds, and they're not characters, they're background.
Yeah. Like, he's the only one that actually gets any lines. And I like that, like, that's not a whole big, you know, thing about the movie or whatever. Like, it's just kind of like, oh, this is just our friend group, and it's all just happens to be female. And yeah, like, Juno turns into, like, at first you think, like, she turns into a badass, but then you see Sarah later, to where she just goes
drenched
full
in blood.
She gets full feral, and it's like, god damn. Like, it's really cool. Not to mention the fact that this film does some great things with lighting. Like, there's, you know, the torch sequence when, you know, via the pool of blood, there's just some, like, really cool...
Some cool shots.
Sure. Well, I mean, plus having the creatures hunt via only sound gets some great levels where we can see the monsters and the characters on screen at the same time, but there's still tension because, you know, the monsters can't see them. And it lets us see these creatures and not rely totally on jump scares the entire time.
Although this movie does have a few too many jump scares with, like, crows and stuff. I'm like, come on.
Oh, you mean the bats and the...
The bat, there's crows too with that elk.
Right. Oh, I also didn't like how the bats were pretty clearly CG as well.
Yeah.
Like, there was like, I mean, this is a 2005 film, so, like, any CG that they would have used would have probably not have dated as well. But luckily, a lot of it is just practical, including the makeup for all of the different crawlers. Now, I didn't know this, but actually, almost all the crawlers are in every scene are acted by a different person.
Huh.
Yeah. Like, there's only a couple times where they repeat people in the crawler makeup. And they were all told to... And they were all professional actors. Like, none of them were stunt doubles.
Okay.
Or, like, stunt people. And they were all told, like, do your own thing with the crawler. Like, everyone was told to, like, make up their own kind of, like, monster character. And that's probably why some of the crawlers act differently than some of the other crawlers. Like, I was noticing that some of them are very, like... animalistic, jump on people's backs and go for the jugular.
Right.
And then some of them one of them was like clawing with his hands and more nervously like trying to claw at one of our characters while they were swinging at them with an axe. Like, he was a little more hesitant. So I thought that was interesting and gave a little more, what do you call it? Like, a little more personality to each individual crawler.
Yeah, like, anytime the crawler showed up on screen, you never knew what was going to happen.
Right. There's also one female one in there, which was weird, too, because I thought they were all hairless, but then there's this one female one that does have a head of hair on it.
Or just was the only one that had hair left.
Sure. Well, they never really go into it, but I feel like this must be, like, you know, some sort of subgroup of humans or whatever that evolved over time to live in, to live in the cave.
Like, yeah, Marshall explained, like, yeah, they don't reveal any of this in the movie. You just find them, these, like, yeah, these basically orc-like goblin human creatures. He explains where the history, where they were humans that just, they were like cavemen. They were cave dwellers, and they just remained in these caves for thousands of years. And it's evolved in such a way where it's like, okay, they just adapted perfectly to their environment without really going outside all that often, except when hunting food. So I was like, that's interesting. They're one of our distant relatives, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, it's no parasite that actually makes people into cave dwelling bat monsters looking your way, the cave. There's gonna be a lot of shade thrown at the cave in this episode, guys, so hopefully you guys aren't fans. But
all I can say is I hope whoever makes out of this movie, like, goes and tells somebody, hey, we have to, like, bomb this place.
Yeah. well, there's a sequel. You know what I really... I mean, I'm not a crazy fan of the sequel either. I'm not sure how you feel about it, Chris, but I taking this own film as its own insular thing.
No, I mean, it works as a single film, and you didn't need a sequel. I mean, sequel's not bad. It's not, like, awful or anything, you know, but it's just, like, it's just unnecessary. It's like, you didn't need to make this. I kind of look at it as the sequel is very much like the Halloween 2. Like, we didn't need, like, Halloween 2 with Michael Myers, like, continuing on with that same night or anything. It's like, this is just superfluous. It's not necessary. And that's where it kind of feels, it's not awful. There's nothing bad about it, really. It's just, I didn't need this. So.
Yeah, so all the cave sequences, all the caves, I think, other than the opening where they first find that opening in the ground, are all sets designed.
Yeah, there's not an actual, like, cave.
And, wow, these sets are really good, guys.
It's impressive.
Like, they're really well, like, I mean, I guess it's probably easier since they can light the thing, like, it's everything is dark and there's only but so much light to go around. But it looks legit. Like, it looks real good. There's a couple points, like, in the cave-in, there's definitely some fake rocks going on. They're okay. But for the most part, it's like, wow, this really looks like a not only a cave, but a cave that's been, like, you know, like, lived in by these creatures. Like, there's, you know, all these different markings in it and that sort of thing. Like, it's really cool. I also like the fact that in the they really put the actors through some work in this one, because the sequence where they first see the crawlers, they had actually never seen what the creatures were going to look like. They knew they were in a creature film, but they didn't know what the creatures were going to look like.
Yeah, like the actual actors.
So during that first sequence, they're all having legitimate reactions to what they look like, and apparently they were screaming and running off set and then laughing later of just like, Jesus Christ. And apparently, yeah, that scene where the first one shows up behind them, like, they shot that scene without them knowing that guy was going to appear in the shot.
That's awesome.
So, like, that reaction when the camera goes around in that night vision or whatever it is.
I'm pretty sure I scream too, so that's fair.
And so, like, that reaction where they all freak out and jump, like, that's, like, a legitimate, reaction. They didn't know he was going to pop up in that shot. Which was pretty cool. I thought it was pretty funny. I mean, if you're squeamish, this is definitely not a movie for you, because, like, even the fact that there's so much blood in it, it's not a splatterfest. Like, you know, we watched Piranha the other day, and, like, that's so much blood that you can easily...
It's actually funny.
You can easily turn your brain off and go, like, isn't that funny? This one feels very
personal,
real.
Almost.
Like there's throats getting ripped out, eyes are getting gouged, and, like, it all is, like, very realistic. Like, there's even that one scene where a character is getting dragged off and they're doing everything they can not to, and their nails get ripped right out of their hands, which is just like, oh, that always gets me.
Have a scene too where they had to reset a person's leg because they're bones literally outside of their skin.
Sure.
That's not pleasant to watch.
But yeah, I mean, I don't know how much I want to go into the whole dynamic between Juno and Sarah, because that's really at the heart of this movie.
It's
a big spoiler. So,
well, let's bring up the one plot point, though, is the fact that they did establish me. Okay, we're going to this park. With the park we're going to. We're going here. And that was a lie.
Yeah, apparently Juno wanted to take them to an unmarked cave system so that they could discover it and name it and have more fun, since the other cave system was supposed to be... They said that was like a level 2. I don't like cave dwell or whatever.
But they basically said, like, oh, this one's too commercialized. It's too for kids and, like, tourists and stuff. I'm like...
Well, half the group seems down with it, and half the group seems like, oh, this is baby stuff. And apparently, like, Juno, like, apparently some of the... It feels like Juno is like, no... She says some sort of line to Sarah, like, isn't that what you always say? If there's no risk, then where's the fun sort of thing? So, it's hard to tell what Juno's thinking was here of like, trying to overdo their special trip. Because she feels like she needs to do this for Sarah or herself or a mixture of the two.
But so, they also, like, they were going to do something smart because, like, oh, yeah, we set up so the fact that if we don't contact this, like, base camp after so many, like, a day or two, they're going to come looking for us because that's smart. And it's like, well, it's supposed to be actually for the other cave. And that's actually even more douchey, because now you know that there's going to be some guy having to go... They're going to have to do a full-on fucking search rescue for those people.
That's what the sequel's all about, actually.
Really?
Yeah, the sequel picks up with all the, with the rescue crew searching the wrong cave.
That's hilarious.
It is funny. Like, I mean, Chris is right. The sequel isn't bad. It's just like, I feel like, you know, like, I don't think there's needs a sequel to this film. Like, or I would have preferred it if it was just a whole different group of cave dwellers fighting these creatures again, rather than a direct sequel. But yeah, I mean, I don't have many negative things to say about this film, other than some of the side characters are just there to be fodder, and it is like, I'm not gonna lie, the if you're in it for just the kills and the creature stuff, it is slow. Like it doesn't really get kicking until about an hour in, and I always realize that, like, oh. And they even have a line about this in the movie about how what time it is, and they do tell you, like, what time night is has come, and that's why the creatures aren't just on their asses the moment that they're in the cave, is that, like, once night falls, they start to, you know, move around and start to actually hunt. Chris, is there anything you wanted to cover that we have not covered yet? Do you have any negatives about the film, possibly?
I mean, the only negatives that, well, you've already brought them up, that I think... One is, yeah, I mean, like I said, some of the supporting characters, they're just there to be fodder. But again, they're not annoying, which I appreciate. They're just there. And then, I mean, they're fine. They have nice chemistry of all the rest of the people in the film. And I think that's what I appreciate about this movie. It's like, I don't hate anyone in this horror movie. I don't want these people to die. I think that was very smart in the filmmaker to, you know, make a film where it's like, I actually like all these people, you know. Yeah, and the other thing is, I think you brought up earlier, is that, yes, there is some CGI in this movie, and that just, it really doesn't hold up. Particularly with the bat sequence, what you see, and it's just like, yeah, it doesn't look good. They use some CGI in the creatures for, like, kind of, like, big wide shots. When you see, like, multiple of them jumping, it's like, yeah. That looks really awkward. That's a green screen shot right there. But yeah, other than that, I mean, it's just a really smartly made a horror thriller. The fact that even when they're in the cave and it's like partially collapsing, like them actually going through it, that's suspenseful. You know, it's just, dark. The fact that it's like, oh, they don't know what the exit is. I mean, they're using all these tricks. I'm like, oh, that's actually really smart. Like, they're using a lighter to detect where air is coming from. You know, if there's a breeze, it's like, oh, okay, that's really cool. And they're using that. Right. It's like, oh, when there's no breeze, well, what the hell do you do? And, you know, I mean, there are some other stakes there when characters are getting injured, when they're climbing across these huge caverns to get to these other places. They're finding, and this is some smart world building in the movie, too, where they're finding old cave-dwelling equipment, you know, or, you know, cave-diving equipment that other people have been here for, like, past decades, or, like, they see even, like, 100 years ago. It's like, wow, that's really interesting. It's smart, and it makes it more suspenseful. So, no, I mean, the movie's just, it's just really good. It's not too long. I think, it must be, like, under an hour or 2 hours, right? Yeah, I think it's 100 minutes, so perfect length for a horror film. So an hour and 40, there you go. So, yeah, it's just, honestly, with the exception of those two things I talked about, it's just one of the best horror films I would say from the mid-2000s. You know, it's one of those films where, yeah, it's like even the sequel, which isn't great, it's not bad, which, you know, so often with horror sequels, they're always terrible. So, no, I really appreciate the movie. And again, I, as a creature feature fan, as someone who loves practical effects, it gives me that. So it's hard for me not to love it.
Are you telling me that the Halloween sequels aren't anything but solid, entertaining films?
You know, well, the thing is, like, even I'm kind of the minority where it's like, I really admire and appreciate the first Halloween film. Like how the just like the watch a documentary how about how that film was made. It was made in 23 days.
Oh,
it was
boy, under I think a Chris month. Is about to say something blasphemous on here.
You know, and like John Carpenter, he was apparently an incredible professional on set. He had his vision. You know, they were way under budget too. The thing is, it's just that unlike The Descent, it's just like I don't like any of those characters. I think that some of the acting is bad. There's some really bad attempts at humor that just don't work. And the film's also really slow. Again, I appreciate the way the actor plays Michael Myers, but I just think it's a really kind of boring movie. You know, it's just not for me. I'm not saying it's bad, but it's just like, I'm not a slasher fan either. I should say that too.
We are not with him.
Like,
opinions of Chris Herman do not reflect the overall opinions of Netflix and Kill. Send all your hate mail.
The thing is, it's just like slasher films. I mean, like with Michael Myers and with Jason Voorhees, they're just these silent mutes wearing masks. It's like the one slasher killer that I actually like is Freddy Krueger, because at least he's interesting. His power set's cool. You know, it's like the fact that he's haunting your dreams and stuff, and he's killing you within your dreams, and you don't know you're in a dream until it's too late. I think that's really interesting. Plus, he's funny, and he talks back to you. I think that's kind of cool. But yeah, I mean,
yeah, I always thought that Michael Myers should say bitch more and then kill people with some more Nintendo Power Gloves, now that I think about it.
Well, my whole thing of Nightmare on Elm Street, it's the first film is great. Dream Warriors is really good, and then New Nightmare.
Dream Warriors kicks ass.
Yeah, it's great. I love Dream Warriors, too. I mean, yeah, you got Dokken doing the song and everything, and then even New Nightmare, it was Scream before Scream was Scream. So, no, I love those three films. But, yeah, I'm not the biggest Halloween or Friday the 13th. Although I am interested in the new movie that's coming out. That looks like, okay, if you're going to just make it be a sequel, it's going to be the last one. Hopefully you're going to end the story. I'm all for that. It looks good. So...
All right, well, while we're still talking about The Descent.
Oh, yeah, that movie, yeah.
What we're talking about?
The only thing I have left is my gay lens, I guess I'm viewing this film through. Because every time I rewatch this movie, I pick up on more and more.
How many times have you watched this movie, by the way?
Mm-hmm, like 3 or 4 times.
Okay.
This one also.
We were watching this, and there was like no tension for me, because Nick was sitting here like, okay, so next, this is happening. Okay, no, these things are going to happen. I'm like, okay.
Like, it's really good. I mean, I always watched this on when we had premium channels, like HBO or something. They'd throw this on, and it was always a fun little movie to have on in the background. So I watched this film quite a few times, actually. Hmm. And every time I rewatch it, I always pick up on, like, you know, it's weird that that it turns out that Juno and Sarah aren't secret lovers. Like... And hear me out, guys. Like, this isn't just me looking for shit. Like, there's weird segments of the dialogue here where, like, Juno and Sarah in the beginning have this weird tension where they're looking at each other, and Sarah's husband is acting all butthurt about something about him, about her hanging out with her girlfriends and stuff. And it's like, oh, what is it? Like, nothing or whatever. And then he dies before he gets a chance to accuse her of cheating on him. And then later, like, Juno shows up with her new friend, Holly. Holly is the new one of the group. And she's introduced as here's Sarah's protege. And they say it, like, with air quotes. And I'm like, what the fuck does that mean?
Yeah, that's a weird line.
Like, there's so many things here that make me think that, like, so are they queer coding these characters or something? Like, and then, like, there's all this dialogue between Sarah and Juno of, like, is this about you, Juno? Is this about you? No, this is about us. And I'm just like, man, I really, I don't think it's, like, it's just my lens here. Or I think I really was supposed to think that they were secret lovers and what was the tension between them. Mm. But it turns out later that that is not the case. So, and we'll go into more of that in the spoiler section.
In fact,
but
it's pretty much the opposite.
But every time I watch this film, I'm just still surprised at, like, how much of, like, man, I really thought this film was going that the one way, and then, like, that, I guess it just did not.
You expected a zig and it zagged.
I don't know. Chris, did you ever pick up on any of that?
I guess, I don't know. I suppose that maybe Holly was gay, but the thing is, that's just not, they don't place importance on the movie not that certain element of it. Again, it's more of a survival story, and that's more of the background thing. I mean, it's not relevant really to the story itself, and so I just kind of, I don't know, brush past it. You know, it didn't And I think that's fine because I don't think that's what's important between these characters. At the very least, I always thought they were friends. Again, with huge fucking issues, like all friends typically have with each other, you know, to some extent. Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, it didn't come across to me like they were trying to make a statement about these characters. It's like, oh, maybe they are, maybe they aren't. You know, it's in the background. Yeah, maybe they have feelings for each other. Who knows? So, I don't know.
Like, I only bring it up because I thought that was going to be the major plot turn.
Oh,
of,
sure.
Like that's the reason that, like, that she feels so guilty, is mm-hmm. that, like, and then Sarah doesn't, like, they probably broke up after that or stopped seeing each other, and now she has this whole guilt of, like, her family die, and then, it's like, this whole thing is Juno's trying to attempt to get her back, sort of thing, or at least get back to, to a point where they're friends, and I'm like, the reveal later is actually interesting because it leads to one of the weird, like, one of the more unique moments out of any horror film.
Yeah.
So it's not like I'm disappointed or anything. I every time I watch the film, I just can't help but, like, man, I really feel like there was another a version of this script that had that as a plot point at something.
I mean, I feel like you're reading a bit too much into it, but I do agree some of those lines do come off weird.
Like
the protege line and the it's for us line is really weird.
Like, there's, like, in... I mean, I guess they could read it in a different light, considering they're friends and they might have their own in-jokes as far as, like, oh, this is her protege or something, mm-hmm. and, like, it was something different, but... I don't know. Overall, I guess we could just, you know, wrap up and give ratings here. I really like this film. I think everything really is firing on all cylinders here. The practical effect work is great with the crawlers. The violence and action is really good. The only thing I think of is that, like, despite the fact that we spend an hour before anyone dies, I feel like if we spend an hour, I should know a little bit more about some of the sub-characters.
I can barely tell them apart.
Well, I mean, especially once we get down there, I do appreciate that Juno is one of the, like, is actually, like, we can tell which one is the Asian chick.
Yeah.
It's like, because they all get so dirty and, like, fucked up, and half of them are blonde, so it's like I did appreciate a little bit of a distinction there, and I feel like I know one of them is a doctor or going to school to be a doctor, and then everybody else kind of, like, is a jumble between, like, oh, I think this character is this, but maybe it's also an amalgamation. Maybe I'm thinking of two other characters. But so I felt like maybe that could have been a little bit stronger. Plus, I just would not have done some of the CG stuff they do in here, considering some of it is very unnecessary. I'm going to give it 4.5 eye gouges out of 5. That's my rating. Travis, how about you?
This was a very solid movie. I actually did like this a lot. It was slow, but I don't think the tension of the cave itself was pretty interesting, so I think the slowness is pretty passable.
I maintain that there's a certain segment, like, once they are caved in, you could have that whole movie about just them being in the cave. Creatures at all.
And then just have tension between the characters instead. But then actually had to develop the other characters.
Sure, sure, sure.
My only real problem is that, like Chris said, they make a lot of smart decisions in the movie. And then there's, like, two characters that essentially commit suicide by being really dumb.
Well, I mean, they are making... One of them makes one of those decisions while she is very afraid. And she is very noticeably, like, holy shit, I don't know what to do. We are so fucked. And she, like, you know, I'm assuming you're talking about the woman that tries to go across, like, the ceiling, right?
Yeah.
Like, yeah. And that one, I'm like, okay, she didn't really make a great decision, but... considering where she was, there wasn't a whole lot of great decisions to be made either in either way, because she was so stuck.
Mm.
But I do agree that Holly feels like she runs off in the, like, oh,
like, for seemingly no reason, she just starts running forward into a cave.
Mm-hmm. I also like that scene also where Juno just jumps off the cliff, like, well, I don't even know if this water is fucking deep enough to catch me or whatever, but at this point, it doesn't really matter.
No, that's the part where I'm like, yeah, you might as well have done that. That at least has a higher chance of, like, success than doing what was it, Becky or Beth?
Sam? I think it was Sam. She was the doctor,
that one was
right?
Sam.
Okay.
Becca was the blonde, I think.
Yeah, okay. They're all blonde.
No, there was a couple brunettes in there that were also confusing.
I have two cousins who are sisters who are named Becky and Beth. I'm getting really fucking confused on names here. It's not helping.
Beth had the black hair, I think. I think Beth had the black brunette hair. Yeah.
I'm sorry, I cut you off before your rating.
No, okay. I got myself distracted. But overall, no, I did like this movie. The crawlers were pretty great. There were some really tense scenes that I did enjoy in this movie, and the ending was very surprising, where it was kind of like, this is good, I don't want a sequel.
Yeah. Chris, bring us home, buddy.
I actually had to give a number rating.
Oh, I'm sorry. You still have not.
Give me a goddamn second, man.
I'm just so excited to get to Chris's rating.
But yeah, I'm going to give it a good solid 7 out of 10.
Which is pretty good, considering a horror movie from Travis.
Yeah.
He's not as big of a fan.
Not a big fan of horror movies, usually.
Chris, what do you think, my friend?
Well, as everyone knows, I'm a sucker for really good creature features. It's rare that we get a good one, at least even once a year. Sometimes it takes a couple years. But this is one of those films that I think does a lot of things right. You have, for the most part, some likable characters. You have some really good performances. It takes place in an environment we don't often see. In many horror films, usually it's like a haunted house type situation. It's like, here, no, I mean, it's in a cave system. You know, yeah, you have The Cave, the movie, which everyone forgot about, but this is the one that did it really right. I love the creature design. Yeah, it's like a mix between like a vampire bat and Gollum. It's pretty creepy. What they do with
them
is really good.
Well, they modeled them to look like after like Nosferatu or something.
Oh, there you go. Yeah, totally. Yeah, I can definitely see that. I think that's what makes them, because Nosferatu is like probably one of the most creepy vampire designs out there. So yeah, very smart on their part to do that. But yeah, I think the kills are visceral and gory as all hell. The environments are interesting. There's some fun world building in there. Some things like, oh, what happened here? It makes you question, and you know, like all these other victims that potentially these crawlers went after and murdered, and we see the evidence of that. I think that's really interesting. Like I said, my only criticism of the movie really is that, yeah, there's some unnecessary CGI, which is like, you could just use practical effects and that would have been just fine, would have hold up. And that's the other thing, the practical effects all hold up in this movie, you know? Even when they're gouging their eyes out and stuff, like, it's like, oh, that's, I just love it, that's great.
Oh yeah, it's great stuff here. I'm gonna try and find the name of the special effects team, actually.
Yeah, and then, my other criticism, I guess, would be, I mean, some of the characters they do, I mean, a couple of them, like, really there's only two dumb decisions in this movie, and you know, by two characters, and that's it. One who gets stuck, and the other one's just like, I'm gonna keep running in the cave. It's like, okay. You know, but other than that, it's like, it's not too bad. I guess it suits their personalities to a certain degree. And I guess the one thing I forgot to bring up, actually, is that the last thing I don't like about the movie probably would be the ending, like the very last scene, the last second. I'm just like, what was that for?
Why'd you do that?
You didn't even need that at all. You could have just cut the movie off at just like right before that. It would have been perfectly satisfying. You know, there's nothing wrong with just like, oh, okay, that was it. That was the adventure. And just, you got to get one more scare in there. And it's a really bad scare too. So that was really awkward, I thought. And that was like, you don't need to do that. But, I mean, overall, still, I mean, again, out of a 100-minute movie, there's about 5 minutes that doesn't really work, you know, which is not bad.
Pretty good rating.
Yeah, so for me, I have to give this 9 out of 10 gory, gooey blood pits.
All right, so we are going to take a small musical break, guys. Thank you so much for joining us for this episode of Netflix Kill. If you'd like to go with some of our back catalog, you know, find some of our back catalog on iTunes, that would be great. Just look under the UGO Network for that and some of our regular episodes. Go back and check out some of the Chris Focus episodes where we reviewed stuff like The Void and Punisher and all that other good stuff with him. Chris, thank you so much again for joining us. It was awesome talking about this really awesome movie with you. Would you like to tell the people where they can find you and your great content?
Sure. You can find me, you can follow me on Twitter at Chris J. Herman. You can also find me on Facebook under Christopher J. Herman. You can check me out on Twitch under Mr. Revan N7. You can see all my content on classintheglass.net, also my YouTube channel, Class in the Glass. I occasionally contribute to oneofus.net, a video, or a film review website. And also recently just started working with Double Toasted for a show called Sammy Ain't Seen Shit, which is a retro movie review podcast. So please check me out on there. I would appreciate it.
Yeah. And check out their latest episode of, Jurassic Park, I believe.
Yes. Jurassic Park.
Great classic film.
Spend no expense.
spared no expense. I am a great fan of Chris's, and he is a stand-up guy.
Thank you.
Looking forward to meeting up with you and maybe doing a in-person recording in Austin.
Yeah.
So that'll be fun too. If you want to follow us on Twitter or Facebook, you can follow us at UGO Podcast or Unapology Geek Out on Facebook. And you know, tell us what you thought about The Descent and Juno or whatever lesbian theories you have about other horror films. Like, I'd love to share them, and definitely share them and go into great detail. But anyway, we're going to take a small musical break, and we'll be back right after this. And we're down, we go, go. Welcome to the spoiler section for The Descent. So, this one, I don't know how long it'll be. I just wanted to talk really about the very ending, like the last 10 minutes even.
Yeah, spoiler, they didn't actually go that far down.
Well, I feel like this is the point where Juno becomes, like, a very interesting character to me. Because earlier in the movie, Juno, while she's trying to save Holly, she's fighting off one of the crawlers. She gets the first crawler kill, and in her moment of fight or flight, Beth sneaks up on her, and she
doesn't announce herself at all.
And she swings because, you know, Beth didn't say that, and all she knows is that she's being attacked. She swings, nails Beth right in the neck, and I love the actress for Beth here. Let me see if I can find her name. She does a great job of looking like, holy shit.
Alex Reed.
What just happened?
Like, Alex Reed is Beth and Natalie Mendoza as Juno. And it's great because it's this whole, like, oh, holy shit. And of course that leads to tension later in the film where she, you know, she basically lies to the rest of the group. Like, I saw Beth die, which, I mean, that's not technically a lie.
It's true, right? It's true.
Like, I mean,
I watched the light leave her eyes might be a more accurate from description, but
from her perspective. So, it's interesting because in a normal horror movie, you'd feel like, oh, I accidentally killed a person. Let me make sure that I get out of here over the expense of everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
And then Juno would become the villain. But that doesn't happen.
Yeah. Kind of the exact opposite happens.
It's actually almost the exact opposite of what happens. Juno becomes racked with even more guilt to the point where she goes and tries to and actually does save more people than Sarah does.
She doesn't really save Sarah, but she goes back for Sarah.
She won't leave without Sarah is what she says, like, I'm not leaving here without her. Because Juno really does feel she is entirely responsible for this.
To be fair, she is kind of responsible.
This was her idea. This is her fault. And Juno, like Natalie Mendoza, plays it that way, where you see it on her face, like, this is all my fucking fault. I can't leave Sarah behind here. I would never, you know, leave her here. And that's the whole idea behind Juno as a character. She's racked with this guilt.
Also, like, get ready for some intense therapy, because, like, stabbing one of your best friends in the throat on accident would not really resolve much issues for you.
And really, I don't really blame her for telling everybody else.
No, I wouldn't.
I mean, you put yourself in that position that only makes surviving that much harder with your friend group if you create that tension amongst the group. And
because then they'll start thinking, like, oh, well, was it an accident, or what's going on here?
Plus, you know, you're deeply ashamed about it, like, and you're still trying to process it yourself. So Juno becomes a really interesting, nuanced character after this, to where she almost reflexively goes in the opposite of trying to save almost everyone she can after that. Like, she only abandons Becca after she's disemboweled by one of the creatures.
Yeah.
Like, she tries her best to try and drag her back. she's yelling, even though she knows that it's better to be quiet, she's yelling for Sarah and Beth and the others to try and find them. She's going against her own survival instinct to try and save the others.
Which is kind of shitty, because some of the other ones literally go, when they hear her screaming, going, oh, that fucking bitch, she gonna die, we don't care.
Yeah, they totally abandon her. Like, Becca and Sam are basically like, oh, she's drawing it towards them, and then I forget if it was Sam or Becca, but one of them says, like, I hope she brings every fucking one of them down on her. And it was like, and it was...
I think it was that tense. I think it was more like, it was more of a line of, like, better her than me type of thing.
Yeah, it was a better her than, yeah, which is...
Yeah,
is,
that's it.
And I'm like, damn, that sucks. And, of course, when Juno saves their asses later, they're all like, oh, thank God you're alive.
Yeah, that's
that
right.
Sort of thing.
So happy to see you.
Uh-huh.
So, and Sarah spends most of the final part of this movie, like, most of the third act, by herself.
Yeah.
Like, by the time she reconnects with the group, only Juno is really left alive. Like, she finds Beth later dying from her neck wound.
Still able to talk.
And Beth reveals
two things.
Well, she's like, don't trust Juno. She did this to me and left me. And then she gives Juno's pendant to her. And it actually has on it the thing that her husband always says. Love, damn it. Live life every day, or love each day.
It's love a each dumb day. Saying. No one cares. I want to say one thing about this. Beth, that was totally on her. That was her fault that she died.
She
who
totally
sneaks up on
Juno.
Someone?
She was
who
like, oh.
Up?
Like, no, go ahead, Chris.
No, I was going to say, who sneaks up on someone after they were fighting two giant, you know, golem creatures? You know, Schmeagle creatures. It's like, no, of course right. You're going to have that reaction. So Beth's like, ooh, you know, you could have said something. But no, she didn't. So, no, totally on her. Juno, that's why I think Juno, she's not a villain. She's not a bad person. She's just like...
Well,
she's the most
you could say someone who cheats
people.
On someone's husband is a bad person, but...
I mean, it's just... She's just... I mean, given the situation, what they just went through... Okay, bad person, yeah, because she manipulated everybody and didn't tell what was happening. Okay, that's on her, too. You know, sure. But at the end of the day, she's not evil. She's not like a, you know, mustache-twirling villain or anything like that. And it's like, okay. And that's why, eventually, what happens to her character, I was like, wow, that's kind of fucked up. I didn't expect that. So... Mm.
No,
surprising.
she's portrayed as this flawed character that
yeah,
you know did cheat on one of her best like cheat with one of her best friend's husbands,
mm-hmm.
Did get them in the situation, but ultimately she is not a selfish person. Like when push comes to shove, for her she is in Sarah's corner and in everybody else's corner, and it is not the same for Sarah.
Or Shekka, whatever one that wants to die, because she intentionally, she's like, oh, this bitch killed me. I'll make sure she dies, too.
Yeah, I almost feel like Beth really had something against Juno to where, like, you know, maybe now I'll give that information. Because obviously she knew beforehand, too, and I'm wondering how many of the crew of the group knew.
Oh,
like, was it everybody but her?
No, I'm sure every single one of them knew.
They kind of seem rather catty.
Man, that sucks.
They talk shit about one another all the time behind each other's backs. That was kind of the big thing. They all hate each other. I mean, it's just like, you know, real life friends.
I did like how they were talking shit about Juno right before they came up to the cabin. And then they were like, oh, hey, Juno, how's it going?
Yeah.
Love you.
Mm-hmm. Like, they did seem like a little bit shitty to one another.
Oh, yeah.
And yeah, like, Beth really does, She totally gives that context to Sarah. And in another movie, Sarah would be the hero fighting Juno as the villain. Like,
yes.
I can't believe you cheated on my husband and left this person to die. But ultimately, like, Sarah does one great act of, like, killing Beth so that she doesn't get eaten alive.
Mm-hmm.
And that's her the most heroic she gets. Because she even hears her friends... earlier in the film, but lets the monsters go and attack them, and then goes off for basically her own way.
Yeah.
And she only really finds Juno later, and at that point, it's hard to tell whether she's trying to find her friends and save them, or if she's trying to fuck over Juno, like, at some point. And she goes full feral, which is, like, she has this really psychotic look. And her and Juno team up at the very end here to have her final brawl, with three of the crawlers so that they can get out of here.
And this is actually when I realized that these women follow the ninja rule.
Yeah.
Because they are shitty when they're all together, but like one-on-one or two-on-one, two-on-a-couple, they are amazing.
So after they kill the three crawlers via like biting and eye gouging and like head bashing and just this great, man, this is a great fucking sequence. Juno and Sarah face off with each other and Sarah reveals the pendant and like doesn't even say, like there's not even one word exchanged between them. And just the look on Juno's face is almost heartbreaking because she's trying to process it like, oh shit, she knows. But then she like looks away because like one of the crawlers is like she hears something in the background, and Sarah just takes a pickaxe to her leg.
Yep.
And it's like, damn, that's gonna be the coldest shit I've ever seen. Like, and I'm trying to see things from Sarah's perspective there, to where, like, you know, in her mind, Juno has killed Beth and fucked her husband. And maybe Sarah has also built up in her head, like, oh, I bet you she left all the other people to die, too.
Yeah, because she did have that line of, like, it's like, are they dead? Yeah. Did you watch them die?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And in Juno's defense, like, she's 100% telling the truth in her perspective.
Well, she does kind of, she stops for just a bit when that she says, like, did you watch it happen?
Yeah. She's remembering Beth, and she's like, yeah, and she obviously doesn't want to tell her.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then, I like, the look that Juno gives Sarah of just, like, this ultimate betrayal of, like, really? You're gonna just leave me here?
Yeah.
And it's so sad, because yeah. Juno has been, like, she won't leave the cave. Like, she even had a chance, to leave everyone, because
mm-hmm.
she found the markings. She could have left everyone to die, and she came back for everyone, but specifically for Sarah.
And Sarah left her to die.
Ultimately be betrayed and left to die like that, and all have like, and not even to have Sarah kill her, but to stab her in the leg so that the fucking crawlers can get her mm-hmm. and eat her alive. And she just has this final like face off between with the pickaxe versus like a just shit ton of these crawlers all on the wall. With the like the flare finally like the going out, and it's just like, damn, like that is
pretty cold.
Like it's a dark, but yet it's a bold ending that I'm like, man, that really makes that it makes it stick out in my mind of just like remembering it of just like, man, this really, really is emotionally impactful. And then we get to Chris's favorite part, like after she escapes, we have a long sequence of her driving away only to end with, because Sarah's been having hallucinations this whole time. She has another hallucination about Juno. And then like in the car next to her, and then she wakes up possibly in the cave. But, and I think I agree with Chris here too, of this, like, I don't think that was necessary.
Nope.
Like it adds an idea of ambiguity that I think it's just over the top. Like I don't think I needed that as well. I don't know, Chris, how'd you feel about
maybe,
it?
Maybe I read the scene differently, because I don't think she woke up like in the cave. She just saw a vision of Juno next to her in the car, and she just started screaming. Was there something I might have missed? Because I don't think it was like she was back in the cage. She's like, oh, it's Juno, and that was it, and then it cuts to black.
Well, we see her eyes open, and we see a black silhouette behind her.
Yeah.
Oh, maybe I completely missed that. Okay.
And then in the sequel, it's revealed that that's her waking up kind of in the hospital, or how we're supposed
right.
to see it. But
yes.
in the film, it's kind of like, oh, maybe she never made it out of the cave.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I just didn't read it that way. I just saw it like, oh, she's just screaming because she sees her, like, a vision in the car, and she's just in the car the entire time. So that's why that's why I felt extra dumb that they included that for me.
If it was me, I would have cut it right after the semi truck honks at her,
mm-hmm. and we've shown her like driving away.
Yeah, because
for me that telegraphs that she's made it to civilization. Yep. Plus, it also it reflects back to the car crash from the beginning of like the honk mm-hmm. and stuff, mm-hmm. and it's like kind of like a come full circle for her sort of thing. Of like another traumatic event that's happened to her. I don't know. I just thought it would have been more impactful if it had just faded to black right there and just kind of left me there on this weird like, well, I guess she survived, but does she really deserve to? I guess is my final question for Sarah. And it's like, It's messy. Like, it's messy to me, because I have a hard time, because I'm the audience and I'm omniscient and I know everything that happened, right, and I get all the context.
You don't actually know her, Lane.
It's hard for me to put myself into Sarah's shoes off of just her info. But yeah, really, really dark. There's also an interesting fan theory in which that people believe that this descent also remarks upon the descent into madness for Sarah's character. And they even go into a full theory that maybe there are no creatures, and that Sarah has just gone mad with grief in the cave, and that she's imagining the creatures while she's murdering her friends.
Ooh.
And that's the only real thing that happened is her killing Juno at the end.
Hmm.
Like, that's why Juno looks so confused and betrayed. And I'm like, oh, that's an interesting theory. I don't think it really holds up.
No, because we see the monsters without her around.
Yeah, we see a lot of things that aren't from her perspective, and we know very clearly some of the stuff that is like her. She only really has hallucinations and dream sequences when she's asleep.
Mm-hmm.
Like, so this would all be just a dream. Like,
well, she does hear her daughter's voice.
Yeah,
around the cave.
That's right. She does hear, like, at one point she does hear that. Yeah. But yeah, like, I don't know, like, I really do, at the end, where I just found it shocking, where I was fully expecting Juno to be our villain of the piece, and when she gets left to die like that, I feel almost nothing but real sympathy for her. Like, goddamn, like, as much as the mistakes you made, I don't think you deserve to go out like that, because that's just a rough way to go. Did anyone else have anything else to bring up in the spoiler section? Chris, anything?
No, nothing off the top of my head. You know, just, I know we're going to get to the kill portion of the thing, so I'll save it for that.
Well, my favorite kill, I have a hard time deciding, because there are so many great kills here. And I would say that, you know, my favorite kill is the one that I always think about. It's not really a kill. It's just that Juno getting left there and Sarah.
Oh, she's dead. We know she's dead.
Sarah leaving her to die. But I mean, well, unless you watch the sequel.
Yeah. Like,
don't plan on it.
So, and to be honest, like, as long as we're talking about spoilers too, the sequel, I do like that they give Juno her full character redemption at the end of that.
Yeah.
But it also has some mixed messages in it as well as regards to the overall guilt complex between the two characters. I don't know. Like, there's some good stuff in the sequel, I'm not gonna lie, but there's some weird stuff in it too. But I like that, and I just like the first kill with Holly, where she gets her throat just viscerally ripped out. Because it's like the first kill, and it's like, holy shit! It really woke me up out of my, like, safe place of, like, oh, well, the monsters haven't really showed up yet, and, like, oh, goddamn, no,
they're here
now. Shit, everything's bad, everything hits the wall. Chris, what was your favorite kill?
Oh, God, that's hard. I mean, Holly's death is a good one, because it's the first one, it's probably the most graphic in terms of just how the creature attacks her. The one that I think is just the funniest death, because it's like, oh, you stupid, you should have done that, is when with Sam, you know, getting stuck hanging above that crevice right there, and that creature just coming for her, slits her throat, and she's like, oh, but she does fight back, she does manage to kill it, but then because of her position, she just bleeds to death and just starts hanging there. It's a cool image, you know, so probably that one, just because of how it's shot, but also just how kind of unintentionally goofy it is on the part of the character, because they basically fuck themselves. So I like it for that reason.
Well, I also like that it's the only scene that's also shared by the cave. The cave has almost the exact same sequence with Piper Perabo.
No kidding.
Which also, I didn't realize this. I thought the cave was later. The cave was 2005 as well.
Huh. Ooh,
yeah.
Interesting. Huh.
These films came out at the same time. That's so weird.
Was the cave a box office success? Because the descent was. It had like a $3.5 million budget. Oh, it's fake British money too. It's pounds, so it's even cheaper than that. So yeah, it made it
British money.
Yeah, that's what it is.
That's funny.
It doesn't matter. It's all fake. If it's a dollar, if it's not a dollar, then I don't understand it. It's not real. It's fake news. But no, I mean, this film had
a pound doesn't even weigh a pound. What is this bullshit?
Yeah, I know. What are we talking about? But no, I mean, the film was a huge box office success. It made almost 20 times its original budget. I mean, I'm going to actually look up The Cave while you're talking, just to see.
Yeah.
I'm curious.
From what I remember, The Cave, I think, had a way bigger budget than that, and I don't think it saw anywhere near the same returns. But I'm just working off of memory here. And that and The Cave doesn't have a great reputation, and The Descent really did have a great, from the get-go of, like, it did bomb.
Yeah, so in a budget of $30 million and a box office of $33 million. So, yeah, pretty bad.
Ooh, that's rough, buddy. Yeah. Sorry, Cole Hauser.
You barely made any dividends on that. Mm-hmm.
Maybe next time. Wait, Lena Headey is in that movie? She's not in that movie.
Wow.
She is in that movie. Holy shit. Okay. So, yeah, everybody watch The Descent. Yes. Don't watch The Cave. So, I think that was our main takeaway from this episode, and if no one has learned anything but that, I think we've done our job. I think this was a grand success. Thank you again so much, Chris.
Of course.
This was absolutely fun. Great pick, by the way. I think it's been my favorite of your picks, and you've had some good ones.
Thank you.
So, thank you, Travis, for joining me. I know you don't like you don't like the tight spaces and the golem creatures.
Well, I mean, it's no the fucking box movie or whatever that one was.
Buried with Ryan Reynolds.
That movie. Fuck that movie.
It's just like I love when we're watching Buried, and Travis is just like, well, I just slit my own throat, just like just immediately.
Are you claustrophobic, hey, Travis? There.
You have the same thing with sharks, so leave me alone.
Well, I mean, I feel like giant monster teeth are more viscerally tear. Like, you know what? We're not talking about each other's phobias. I think everyone's just afraid of something. So, I really had a fun time, guys. Yeah. So, thank you so much. We will catch you at the next one. Otherwise, we are on Apology Geek Out, and we're out.